be here is to attend a conference called as Smart Hospitals, and we are smart enough to manage it on time with a delay of 15 minutes. I apologize for the same. The idea is, we've been in healthcare since last 10, 12 years, and we were always struggling to get to know what would be the way forward. So the typical module would be equating to it. How we become smart enough to take care of various things. We always talk about, discussed about various issues like Ayushman Bharat, which is supposed to come, and there are multiple issues which are supposed to come up in the present healthcare scenario. So I'll just take you another 10 minutes, what was the concept and why we had come up with the concept of starting a conference on smart hospitals. If you see the present healthcare scenario, India is the fastest economy, which is growing with 7.5%. It's more than $180 billion economy. But on the other side, the number of physicians per patient is hardly 0.6. The number of sub-centers, the nursing staff what we have is still not which we can help them out to cater a patient in a better fashion. So now, the biggest problem what we can see is in the present scenario is, thanks NPPA, they had given a price barrier for cardiac stents. Everybody talks about it. We have price capping for multiple procedures. Ayushman Bharat coming in with more than with less than 30% lesser price list with the existing RS2I price list. How are we supposed to come up with all these problems? So there's a reason, the solution, we have to be a smart hospital. So how can we become a smart hospital? It can be four aspects of it. One, it can be a smart infrastructure. Second is, we can have operational efficiency in the existing hospitals. We can have clinical competency in terms of increasing our efficiency towards the clinician versus patient time. We can also get into patient-centric approach. So let's get into the first point, how we can become a smart hospital in terms of infrastructure. The first one is, generally whenever you are building up a new hospital, we always prefer running all its, generally I used to always say to my clients, it's easy to build a hospital, but it's difficult to run and sustain a hospital. So there's a reason sustainability of that particular infrastructure should be there. So we nowadays we call it as a green hospital, or what we call it as a smart hospital, which can breathe itself, which can generate some electricity for itself, which can reduce the water consumption of the same hospital premises, so that my P&L reflects some good more profit revenues on the balance sheet, because my wings are already cut by, thanks to the Ayushman Bharat, almost 30% has to be deducted from the existing price list. So in that case, if we are able to get a green hospital, that would be a better way to move forward. Now, whenever you are building up a new hospital or you are renovating your existing one, you can consider 8 to 10 points which will help you out in doing that. The first is, whenever you are designing it, don't design it for today. Average life of a hospital is close to 60 years. Typically, whenever we build it up, the structure should be designed for 60 years. We don't consider our futuristic approach. Whatever we can see in the present scenario, we design those hospitals as to the present market. So don't do third copy paste from the existing competitor. Do your homework well. Try to make a futuristic design for your hospital. I'll give an example. We have a recent example wherein a client has asked me for a twin sharing room. But if you see in the western part of the world, there is no sharing rooms. So tomorrow what will happen is, India, 8 or 10 years down the line, when Ayushman Bharat has come in the picture, where everybody is able to pay you 5 lakh rupees per patient, automatically there is demand for a private room. So automatically the number of individual beds will go up. So that's the reason I'm saying we have to get into a futuristic design. Second, as I already said, green hospitals. So that's what it is, a sustainable design. We have to do a design which can sustain itself. A hospital should sustain itself. Majority of the time, we always talk about how the flow of a doctor and a vendor will happen. But most important part is how it should be a patient-centric design, because the core of the design is the patient. Majority of the time, it's not the patient who cry, it's the patient relative who comes up with various issues. And that's what I believe has to be added up in your design. So the moment you start giving value-added services to the patient relatives, for example, there is a dedicated patient relative lounge, there is a sitting areas for the patient relatives, so automatically it will help them out in the design part of it. Typically, a single doctor-owned mid-sized hospital, they have their own clinical workflow and they prefer it should be three OPDs interconnected and so on and so forth. But it has to be a mutualized understanding. I'll give an example. We had recently built a 30-bedded hospital which is owned by a clinician who is practicing from last 25 years, and he wants the way he practices in his case methodology, he wants to do the same thing. But now the second generation is supposed to come up. Then he realized, okay, current might be my workflows are not working well for me. Let's build a standard clinical workflow so that we can have a better workflow of OPD management. Typically, how we practice in the clinical side with evidence base. So similarly, we have to have an evidence based design also. So if you can see the picture on the rightmost corner, you can see there is a hand sink, there is a hand wave which helps the patient directly walk towards the toilet. So that's evidence. In the night time, whenever a patient walks towards the toilet, it's always difficult to find a toilet. And it should be the minimum distance from the patient bed to the toilet. It should not be the closest for the patient related. Whatever we had designed today with the best of our understanding might be tomorrow, it might be not the best design. So there's a reason we always say there is a big risk for today's well-intentioned design. Decision will turn to a bad design tomorrow. Whenever a mobile company, Nokia always says make it simple. So I always remember whenever we get on working on hospital designs, a smart hospital should work on make it simple. How a literate or unliterate person will find the signage program. So if you can see there in the lobby. So NICU, you can see there is a purple color, yellow color for PICU and CICU, and green is for PICU. So it typically works on the clinical floors as well as the OPD cluster. Even an uneducated person post Ayushman Bharat impact, automatically a person who is not literate enough also has a capability to get stepped in into a corporate hospital. So for him, identification of which OPD would be there is a difficult task. So automatically you can say, okay, follow the green line, you can go to the OPD of orthopedic. Blue line, it goes towards the cardiac OPD, something like that. Healing design is always important. Whenever the more greener, and we always say like there are two aspects of it. One is from the design time, and how soon a patient recovers from your design, it helps you out to turn around. The moment your average length of stay is reduced for a patient, automatically your top line increases. On the top, on the other side also, your bottom line also makes more profit. Majority of the time, whenever I entered into major hospitals, I didn't found this barrier-free design in the hospitals. What is barrier-free is like, it's not, the hospital is not designed for healthier people. It is supposed to be designed for a disabled people. And majority of the time, it's very difficult to find a handicapped toilet. If a blind person just entered into a hospital lobby, it's difficult for him to reach the rooms. The reception. So we have to consider those kind of things in our design line. And mark my word, tomorrow it would be a guideline to get into it. So the smart hospital would be nothing. It would be a integration of all the infrastructure, interconnection, paperless, mobile care, working clinics, wellness, telehealth, retail, which will come into the picture now. Typically, there is a 33% of the complete revenue goes towards the pharmacy, and now it's almost 30% of the retail which comes into the healthcare. Recently I've been to a chain of clinic called as, not clinic I can say, the chain of pharmacy which is Wellness Forever, and they have more than 60 plus retails here. Almost 300 square feet, 100 square feet is dedicated for the medicines and the remaining 200 is for retail. So retail would be tomorrow a big business market. So hospice has to get into a retail tomorrow by default. Those days are gone when a patient comes to a doctor and doctor serves him. Now it's more on a home health care and the point of care devices which has come in picture, which helps doctors to get a live monitoring of the patient. Recently, RFIDs have started getting into the hospitals. Now, RFIDs, one fine day I was just wondering, I have a small kid back at my home, she is 2 years old, and the school guys has given a tag with her and saying, you can see where your kid is moving in. I'm like, are you sure? Yes. The moment I started my app, I can see, okay, fine. My kid is playing in the garden and then she shifted back and now she's traveling from school, coming back to my home. So that helps me out. Then I realized majority of the time being an administrator, 60% we were struggling to find housekeeping guys, nurses and ward support guys. So if we have a same RFID, we can easily track the where our resources are, which medicine is traveling towards which direction. There, we always invest more than 20 to 30% of our time to identify where are the surgical equipments have been parked in CSSD, in OT or in the stores. Couple of times there are single use items which can be also added up as a RFID. Similarly, we can use RFIDs for the security and the laundry purposes. Modular OTs are something which is everybody talks about, but now a step up is a integrated OTs, wherein they prefer there should be an integration with the other surgeon. If I'm a surgeon and I need a second opinion for another consultant who can come in, those days are gone when there is a ghost surgeon comes in, perform the surgery and goes out. Now people started saying, okay, why can't we have an integrated modular OT, and we can have a second opinion during the surgery if there is a complicated case. We can have been, for an example, Neil and Howard can give us a second line of a treatment, why can't we perform the surgery in another fashion. So integrated modular OTs would be the way forward. So this all about more, everything talks more about the infrastructure. Now we have to be thinking on one more line called as operational efficiency. So operational efficiency, I mean to say, like we can install lots of building management systems which can help us out to identify where are we moving, which assets are lying parked up. So we call it as a assets maintenance. Majority of the time we are not aware of what are the assets we have and where they are parked. In my hospital, I always find multi-para monitors are missing, and then one storekeeper will come in and say, sir, we have this tag here and this is the reason we parked them under the maintenance department. So that's the second challenge for the maintenance. So we can have asset management things online. We can have network infrastructure, mobile assets tracking. We can also have a medicine supply through e-logins. Hospital pharmacies can be more as paperless. A doctor can prescribe directly from his OPD to the pharmacy, and the prescription directly goes to the pharmacist, or vice versa. A doctor can check whether we have that medicine in the inventory or not, otherwise it would be a loss of a prescription. Similarly, we can work on multiple aspects on clinical excellence, which includes nurses, doctors, radiological department, and there could be integration of typically what happened is, I do remember I recently met a startup saying, sir, we are an integrated ecosystem for IT. So what is the integrated ecosystem? So typically what happened is, a patient comes to a doctor writes multiple tests. The patient goes to a pathology for the sample collection, then he goes to another diagnostic center for the CT scan. And then in the evening he comes back, takes his reports, goes to the CT scan center, gets the CT scan, and then comes back to the doctor. He has lost almost 20 to 30 minutes or 40 minutes in the same. So now it's integrated with the closest pharmacy, OPD, and the diagnostic centers are integrated. So we can, at least the clinician will spend more time with the patient to get a better outcome. We had recently seen a couple of patient evidence-based medicine where a doctor can, or we can call it as a patient decision support, doctor's decision support system. Whatever the medicine what he is giving, the AI can help them out in identifying the line of treatment. So considering all this, we will start the conference and we'll get into the second mode. That's the concept of smart hospital, what we're trying to get into it. Thank you.